days earlier. All of his family and friends were sad. After he died, he had been buried in a tomb. His family and friends missed him very much.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene and some other women went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been rolled away.
Now Mary stood outside the tomb, crying. As she cried, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and another at the foot.
They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?"
"They have taken my Lord away," she said. "I don't know where they have put him."
At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus.
He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?"
Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have put him and I will get him."
Jesus said to her, "Mary."
Now Mary recognized him. It was Jesus. He was alive.
Mary Magdalene ran to tell the disciples the news. "I have seen the Lord."
Now all of Jesus' friends and family were very happy.
Jesus is alive. Happy Easter.
So sweet. Thank you for being part of our Easter program this morning. We're going to stand again and sing In the Garden. Please stand with me as we sing 267 in your hymnal. Greet one another this morning. if you can return to your seats, we're going to finish in the garden on the second verse.
He speaks and the sound of
seated. And now the choir is going to sing, "He is risen indeed."
With the final cry of, "It is finished," Jesus completes his mission. His lifeless body is buried in a borrowed tomb where a heavy stone covers the opening and Roman soldiers stand guard. His disciples grieve the loss of their master and friend and the end of their hopes and dreams. Early on Sunday morning, several women go to the tomb to anoint his body. They arrived to find the stone rolled away and the Savior's body gone. Suddenly, two men appear and ask, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen."
Christ's disciples lift their eyes. He left the throne of heaven to come to Bethlehem, and I would not forget the way he loved me even then.
And everywhere spoke with words of love that said he'd go to any distance to show what I was worthy of. And when at last the dusty road turned to
on that hillside.
for all you offered up your life. For one and all, for one and all, the perfect sacrifice. Atoning blood was shed, love conquered when you said, it is finished, it is done. To the world salvation comes. Hallelujah, we're alive. Hell was silenced when you cried, it is finished, it is finished. Who is this king? Who is this king? So mighty and so strong. He is the one, he is the one the earth has waited for. God's remedy for sin, with mercy for all men. It is finished, it is done. To the world salvation comes. Hallelujah, we're alive. Hell was silenced when you cried, it is finished, it is finished. The earth shook and trembled, the sun bowed its head. The veil of the temple was open for man as Jesus went down in the cold of the grave, defeated the darkness when he overcame. The keys of the kingdom were placed in the hands of children and priests and of fishers of men. Through all generations his voice will be heard. Creation resounds the victorious words. It is finished, it is done. To the world salvation comes. Hallelujah, we're alive. Hell was silenced when you cried, it is finished, it is done. Now completed the work of love. Hallelujah, he's alive. Join the song of the ransom bride. It is finished, it is finished, it is
beautiful song. It is finished. So let's stand and sing What a Savior. I think that's on 283 in your hymnal. What a Savior.
Hallelujah. Now we're going to have Nancy and Ellen come and play for us. And what a blessing that will be.
Thank you. There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain, I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise, I will rise. There's a thing that's drawing near when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is one. He is risen.
Sometimes you just never know what a tape is going to do. So as we regroup, let's stand and sing, "Jesus is Coming Again."
I'll be dismissed after the first verse.
If Children's Church hasn't left already, they need to do so. They couldn't make it. Open your Bibles to Acts chapter 2 this morning. I enjoyed all the singing. Wasn't it good? Even if it was a little out of kilter there, it was still really good. This past week, as I was thinking and meditating and seeking the Lord of what I should bring to you on this Lord's Day, what would God have me to preach to you about the resurrection of our Lord Jesus? And I decided it's not so much what people want to hear. You know, not so much, you know, you preach something to gather and hold their attention, but what would God really have me to say about the resurrection? You know, you could preach all day long on what proves the resurrection. You know, what are the things in the scriptures that prove the resurrection? And there have been books and books and books that would fill library shelves, if not libraries, on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But how can we prove the resurrection? If it's so central to the Christian faith, how do we prove it? What is it that Jesus, that really proves that Jesus rose from the dead? You want the answer? The Bible. Isn't that a no-brainer? You people need to smile more. You're looking really bad. Yeah, it's the Bible. And so the answer to the question, did Jesus rise from the dead, is very simple because it's found in the Bible. And so today I don't want to try to prove to you the resurrection took place. The issue today is really not what proves the resurrection, but what does the resurrection prove? I'm going to turn it around a little bit. What does the resurrection prove? What did the resurrection of Jesus Christ really mean? What did it verify? What did it accomplish? What did it prove? And so this morning I want to look at a couple realities that are proven by the resurrection of our Lord. And the first one is found here in Acts chapter 2. And that is, the resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. The resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. Sometimes we think about it the other way. The Word of God proves the resurrection, but we're going to see just in a moment it's the other way around. And so let's look at Acts chapter 2, beginning at verse 22. The Bible says, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands, have crucified, and put to death, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it." And so here we have Peter giving the news to the Israelites that Jesus Christ, whom he had taken and crucified, God had raised again from the dead. Verse 25, though, he begins to quote from the Old Testament. It says, "For David says concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh also will rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in your presence." And so here Peter quotes from the Old Testament. He quotes from David's Psalm 16. David, hundreds of years before Jesus walked the earth, was talking about this one who was going to come, this one who was going to die, this one who would not see corruption, this one who would rise from the dead. David was speaking of a prophet. Look at verse 29. "Men and brethren, let me speak freely of you, of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us today." And so what he's saying is David wasn't speaking of himself. David was speaking of someone else. Now look what he says in verse 30. "Therefore, being a prophet," he calls David a prophet. David was a prophet. He was prophesying about this one who was coming, this one who would not taste death. "Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit on his throne." And so the Old Testament, speaking here in Psalm 16, it predicts the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. If Jesus did not rise from the grave, then the Bible isn't telling us the truth. David was lying to us. David was a false prophet. But the resurrection of Jesus Christ proves that the Bible speaks the truth. And so what does the resurrection prove? It proves the truthfulness of the Bible. It proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. Flip in your Bibles to Acts chapter 13, and let's look at another verse from the Old Testament that's given to us that the resurrection proves. Acts chapter 13, beginning in verse 29. "Now when they had fulfilled all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. He was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. And we declare to you the glad tidings, that promise which was made to the fathers." Again, made to the fathers, referring probably to Genesis 3:15. "God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus, as it was also written in the second psalm, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you.'" Jesus Christ, when God raised him from the dead, proves and attests to Psalm chapter 2. It goes on to say, and that he was raised from the dead, no more to return to corruption. He has spoken to me, I will give you the sure mercies of David, Isaiah 55:3. And then verse 35, "Therefore he also says in another psalm, Psalm 16:10, you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption." And so the scriptures are at stake. If Jesus Christ did not rise from the dead, then Psalm 2 is false. Psalm 16 is false. Isaiah was a liar. And so the resurrection of Jesus Christ proves our scriptures to be 100% true. That's why the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so important. The very scriptures themselves are at stake. If Jesus Christ did not rise from the dead, then we have a Bible, that you have a Bible on your lap that is full of nothing but lies, untruths. But the resurrection of Jesus Christ proves beyond any reasonable, any shadow of a doubt that Jesus Christ rose from the dead and that the Bible that you possess is 100% truth. Flip now to Acts chapter 26. Verse 22 says, therefore, having obtained help from God, to this day I stand witnessing both to small and great, saying no other things than those which the prophets and Moses said would come. And so the prophets and Moses said that this was coming. What was coming? Verse 23, that the Christ would suffer, that he would be the first to rise from the dead and would proclaim light to the Jewish people and to the Gentiles. And so what we have given to us here in the scriptures is that Moses and the prophets, all the way back to the book of Genesis, proclaimed that Christ was going to come and that Christ would come and rise from the dead. And so what the resurrection of Jesus Christ does for us today, it authenticates the Bible. The prophecies that were given hundreds of years, thousands of years in some cases, before Jesus walked the earth, proves who Jesus was, and Jesus proves the scriptures to be true. Look at one other verse in Luke chapter 24. I know it's a Bible lesson for you today. Luke chapter 24. Let's begin at verse 25. Then he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart, to believe it all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to have entered into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Then they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would go no further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them. And so it's look at verse 31. Then their eyes were open and they knew him and he vanished out of their sight. Jesus is walking with his two disciples on the road to Emmaus. And he says, how is it that you are slow of heart, that you don't understand what the prophets have spoken? Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? The Old Testament from cover to cover of the Old Testament is just plastered with the truth that Jesus Christ, the Christ, was going to come and he was going to be crucified and he was going to die upon that cross and he was going to rise again from the dead. And so the resurrection of Jesus Christ proves beyond any doubt whatsoever that the Old Testament scriptures are the Old Testament scriptures. The resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. Aren't you glad of that today? You don't have to take my word for it. We have history to attest to. Jesus Christ is alive today, and the Bible proclaimed it thousands of years before he walked the earth. And so the resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. Let me give you another thought here today. The resurrection proves not just the truthfulness of the Word of God, but the resurrection proves the deity of the Son of God. Jesus Christ was God, amen? That's important for us today to understand that. When Jesus died on the cross, not only did he die for his sins, which he didn't because he had no sins. When Jesus died upon that tree, he died for all of our sins. And he could do that only because of who he was. He was the God-man. As man, he could die in the place of man. As God, he could take that sacrifice and multiply it eternally. And so I'm glad today that I can stand here on this Easter morning and proclaim that Jesus Christ is alive, because Jesus Christ was God in the flesh. He took upon himself my sin. He suffered my hell, so there's no hell left for me to suffer. And today, on this resurrection morning, we can praise God and thank God for his great love. For God so loved me that he gave his only begotten Son for me, because Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And really, there's no greater proof anywhere in the scriptures than the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. Only God can give life. Only God can give life. Only God can conquer death. And that's exactly what we would expect, and that's exactly what we see in the person of Jesus Christ. In the New Testament, you find all kinds of people giving testimony to Christ as being God. Some are really amazing, like the demons in Mark chapter 5. It says, "And they cried with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with you, Jesus, the Son of the Most High? I implore you, by God, that you do not torment me.'" The demons understood that Jesus Christ, though a man, was more than a man. He was the God-man. He was God in human flesh, God incarnate. That's the person that we're worshiping here today. That's the person that we have come to proclaim and lift up our hands to praise, because he has saved us from our sins. We have something to proclaim today. The resurrection of Jesus Christ proves the scriptures, but it also proves that Jesus Christ was more than a man. He was the God-man. Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." Nathanael said, "You are the Son of God." And Matthew said, "He is God with us, Emmanuel. God walked the earth for us." Mark and Luke said the same thing. He is the Son of God. All the writers of the New Testament affirmed the deity of our Lord. And then John the Baptist said, "I saw him bear record that this is the Son of God." And Martha says, "I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God." The Roman soldier even said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." You know what Jesus was? Hey, he was the Son of God. So today we can celebrate a truth that Jesus Christ is alive today. He knows us by name. He died on the cross for you and for me. And today we have the privilege of saying his name publicly. We have the privilege of proclaiming the truth of what he has done for us. And by proclaiming the truth of the resurrection, it proves the scriptures. And it proves that Jesus Christ was who he claimed to be. Jesus said this of himself. He says, "If you have seen me, you've seen the Father. I and the Father are one." They're the same. If you go to Romans chapter 1, you don't need to. I'm going to read it to you. As Paul begins this wonderful book to the Romans, he says, "Paul, a bondservant, a slave of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God," not the gospel of Jesus Christ, but the gospel of God. The scriptures is telling us that Jesus was more than a man. Jesus was God himself. It was the good news of God. Verse 2 says, "which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures." And so all the way back through the scriptures, into the prophets, even into the book of Genesis, they proclaimed the truth that Jesus was God. Verse 3 says, "concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection of the dead." The resurrection of the dead proved that Jesus Christ was God in the flesh. And so today we can celebrate that marvelous truth. God raised him from the dead because of who he was. He was God himself. And so the resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. The resurrection proves the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ. But the third thought here this morning is the resurrection proves the completion of the salvation of God. The resurrection proves the completion of the salvation of God. In Romans chapter 4, verse 25, the Bible says, "who was delivered up because of our offenses and was raised because of our justification." Jesus went to that cross because we were sinners. He went to that cross of his own volition, of his own choice, so he could take upon himself the sins of the world and be separated from his Father as he hung suspended between heaven and hell. He did that for us because that was the only way that God's plan of salvation could be completed. The resurrection proves the completion of the salvation of God. How does it do that? Because it says he was raised for our justification. You know, when the Bible says that his name shall be called Jesus, that's the Old Testament name of Joshua, and it literally means Jehovah saves, that's exactly why Jesus came into the world, to die upon that cross, to save mankind, to save you and to save me, to give us hope from the grave. And so in order to accomplish this salvation, he had to raise Jesus Christ from the dead, and the Bible says exactly that, that he was raised for our justification. In other words, the Father says, "I've accepted your sacrifice. I accept your sacrifice." And because he accepted that sacrifice, that means that our sins were forgiven. And when Jesus said it was finished, truly it was. It was done. And today we can proclaim that marvelous truth that God so loved me that he gave his only begotten son. There's so many features of our salvation that are contingent on the resurrection. In John chapter 11, we see the aspect of eternal life. I am the resurrection and life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Again, it's the resurrection that gives us the hope of eternal life. In John chapter 17, he says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. Jesus Christ had to die. Jesus Christ had to rise from the dead. Jesus Christ had to ascend into heaven so the Holy Spirit could be given to us today. The seal of our salvation, the Holy Spirit lives within us. We are his temple. He came to forgive us of our sins. He came to bestow upon us spiritual gifts. Every aspect that you can think about that pertains to our salvation has its root, has its foundation in the very resurrection of Jesus Christ. If there was no resurrection of Jesus Christ, there's no Christianity. If there's no resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Bible's a lie, because the resurrection proves the Bible, not the other way around. You see, the Bible simply proclaimed what was going to take place. And when it took place, that certified the truth that they had written. And so the resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God. The resurrection proves the deity of Christ. The resurrection proves the completion of our salvation. Isn't it great? I'm saved today. I don't know about you folks, but I can proclaim Christ today. And if you're not saved today, you can proclaim it too. All you have to do is to turn from your sin, you repent of your sin. Confess your sin. I know that I'm a sinner, God. I know that I have turned my back on you. And I realize because I'm a sinner, the wages, what I get paid for being a sinner is death, eternal separation from you. And I don't want that. Jesus Christ came and paid your sin debt and rose from the dead to proclaim that it was completed for you. And all you have to do, after you realize who you are as a sinner, you turn to God in faith and you say, save me. You say, save me. God made it so simple. And we have a tendency to mess it up all the time. But it's so simple. Whosoever will may come. The offering is always open every day. But one day that offering will be closed and you won't be able to come. The resurrection proves the completion of our salvation. The fourth one I want you to give is the resurrection proves the establishment of the church. Jesus said in Matthew 16, verse 18, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Who's building the church? Jesus said, I will build my church. And so that tells me that he had to rise from the dead. Dead people can't build anything. Jesus Christ isn't dead. Jesus Christ is alive. And he's building his church. This is part of his church. You are part of his church. You're a brick in his building. The eternal church. And someday he's going to come, and he's going to call his church into his presence. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. That's my mom and dad. Then those of us who are alive remain at that time shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Now, brother, that's exciting. And it's all because Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and Jesus Christ is building his church. Death couldn't stop Jesus from building his church, because he was God in the flesh. Ephesians chapter 1 says it this way, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. He's somebody special. And then it says, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. The church is the body of Christ. You're part of his body. He brought you into him. Jesus Christ, with his resurrection, proves the establishment of the church. And then the last one here this morning. We talked about the resurrection proving the truthfulness of the Word of God. That's cool, don't you think? Can you say cool in the pulpit? It's cool. It just is. Well, it is. The resurrection proves the deity of Christ. My God's God. The resurrection proves the completion of our salvation. When Jesus said it was finished, it was finished. He could say that. Nobody else, because of who he was. The resurrection proves the establishment of the church. It was his body. He had to rise from the dead, but there'd be no church to be built because dead people can't build anything. And then lastly, the resurrection proves the inescapable judgment of God, which is to come. In John chapter 5, look in your Bibles there real quick and we'll be almost through. John chapter 5, verse 21. It says, "For as the Father raises the Son and gives life to them, even so the Son gives life to whom he will. For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son. And all should honor the Son, just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death unto life. Most assuredly, I say to you, the hour is coming and now is when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who will hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and has given him authority to execute judgment, also because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation." There's a judgment coming, beloved. There's a judgment coming if you do not know Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. We'll never be condemned because our sins have been forgiven. We are pure, perfect in God's sight because of who Jesus was and what Jesus accomplished for us. But there is a judgment to come. For us that are born again, this is the judgment of works in the sense of receiving our rewards when we stand before the Lord and we praise him with what we've done in our life. So often we think that salvation simply is all there is to it, but it's the very beginning of what we are, what the church is. We receive Jesus Christ as our Savior. We begin to grow in this intimacy of this relationship so then we can dedicate our lives in absolute total surrender to him. Everything we do to glorify him. And then someday, at the judgment seat of Christ, God will reward us for that. And we'll take the crowns that we have on that day and we'll cast them at his feet as we glorify him. So many people today are just so interested in receiving Jesus Christ as their Savior. And that's the end of their life in Christ. That's the very beginning of your life in Christ. That's not the end of your life in Christ. But we think that it is. Most people are just concerned with fire insurance. I don't want to go to hell. But there's so much more to Christianity than just that. And so, Christian, you're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But beloved, there is another judgment coming. This is a great white throne judgment. And those people that have rejected Jesus Christ and the salvation that he offers, the resurrection that he's given, this will be your judgment. And it'll be a judgment of your works in the sense that you're at the great white throne judgment because you have rejected Jesus Christ. And so that's one judgment there. This judgment, though, will determine the severity of the hell that you will suffer forever and ever and ever. And ever. It tells us in Revelation chapter 20 that the dead were judged out of the books. And then the book of life was opened. And if your name wasn't found in the book of life, which it will not be at the great white throne judgment, God takes you and he hurls you into the lake of fire. That hurl word there is interesting. It means to be thrown by great force. God has done everything that he possibly can to tell people about his great love, to tell people about Jesus Christ, to tell people about what was accomplished at the cross. And still people today ignore the truth of the gospel. You ignore it at your own risk because death comes to all people. The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die and after this to judgment. Death comes, one out of one people seem to die. But you know what's true? Those of us in Christ have the possibility of never dying because of the rapture of the church. And that's for God's people. So God has called us to preach the gospel because people need to hear the gospel. Amen. And people still reject the gospel. I remember as a young man, I didn't have time for the gospel. I had my whole life in front of me. I have so many things I wanted to do. And church wasn't one of them. Sitting in church listening to some guy speak I wasn't interested in. But then I heard the voice of Christ call to me from the Word of God, just some pastor who was speaking. And I realized my lost condition, and I realized that I needed something that I wasn't getting anyplace else, and that was Jesus. And that began my trek through my life, and it's not over yet. Each day I learn and grow more and more in my understanding of who Christ is. That is what Christianity is all about, having that intimacy with the living God. And if you don't have that intimacy with the living God, I offer him to you today. Don't leave here today unless you have it, because that is what Christianity is. It is not a religion. It never was a religion, but we've made it into a religion. It's not a religion. It's a relationship with a living creator of all things who wants to have a living relationship with you. Jesus Christ is not just a name in a book. He's a person who lives within us. He owns us. He bought us. And the price was his own life. But God showed his love toward you in that he raised Jesus from the dead. And through that, he justified you. He declared you to be something that you're not, righteous. Even though we're born again, we still sin. But positionally speaking, we need to praise God for, because he doesn't cast us out. He looks at us and he justifies us. He declares us to be righteous. We're justified in his sight. And so today, I want you to understand as you leave here today that the resurrection proves the truthfulness of the Word of God, not the other way around. The resurrection proves the deed of Christ. It proves the completion of our salvation. It proves the establishment of the church. And it also shows, according to Jesus here in John chapter 5, that there is a judgment coming. It's inescapable. You might think, well, I got 20 years, 30 years, 50 years. You don't know what you have. Young people die as well as old people. It happens when you least think it's coming. It comes. Do you know Christ as your Savior today? If Jesus Christ comes asking for your life, do you know what your eternal destination is going to be? Do you know Christ as your Savior? Have you given your life to him? Are you growing in him? Beloved, this is Resurrection Sunday. As I said this morning at the sunrise service, every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. We gather on the first day of the week to proclaim a truth. And for 2,000 years, the church has done that. You know why? Because Jesus Christ is alive today. And we proclaim that truth. Are you proclaiming that truth? Don't keep it hid under a basket. Jesus says, launch out, put it on a lampstand. Let everybody see it. Let everybody hear it, because they need to. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much this morning for your word. We thank you, Father God, for the joy of understanding that the resurrection of Christ, which is a historical fact, proves so many things in our life. Lord, it isn't that we just have a book that tells us all of these things, though we do have a book that tells us those things, but the resurrection of Christ in history proves those things to be true. And so when we find Jesus' name in the Bible, Father, it's just not a name in a book. It's not a fictional book. It's telling us the story of a real person, a real man who was the God-man who came to the earth and died in my place on that cross so I could come and live with you forever with my sins forgiven. Father God, I pray that today you touch our hearts, that we would leave this place this morning, just proclaiming the name of Jesus, thanking him so much for doing what he did to give us eternal life. I am the resurrection and the life, he said. I thank you, Father, for that. And Lord, even if I die, I have life because I have Jesus. And I pray, Father God, if there be someone here today that doesn't have life because they don't have Jesus, there's no reason for them to leave here today without him. The gift of salvation is offered freely. He paid the price. All we have to do is receive it by faith. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And so, Father, on this Resurrection Sunday, we proclaim the name of Jesus. Speak to our hearts, Father God, and draw us unto yourself, that we might proclaim his name until he comes. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.